To be a practitioner of Buddhism in the West?
It's a pioneer. So 30 or 40 years ago, there were two main teachers, two main influences, and one was Suzuki Roshi with his Zen Mind, Beginner's Mind book, very simple, very straightforward, very attentive to the North American mind. And then the second teacher was Jogyen Trungpa Rinpoche with his Cutting Through Spiritual Materialism, which was amazing in his ability to understand the Western mind. And so this was captivating, very, very intriguing, and very, how do you say, on the mark. Yeah. With time, these have become established, and Buddhism is now pretty much mainstream. It's well accepted, it's well understood, basically, in a general sense, or well accepted, perhaps. And so it's a little easier. You're less of a single individual in a great mass of unknowing. There's lots of people now who practice Buddhism, so it's a lot easier. Still, there's much, much work to do. You know, we think of it as a kind of a 500-year project.
It's a long story, very long story. I was first attracted by Zen because I read Suzuki Roshi and many other Zen teachers. And I would say that before reading Trungpa Rinpoche, the Zen tradition was attracting me more because of the type of aesthetic. And I enjoyed also reading haiku and poetry coming from the Zen tradition. So it's the literary attraction that I had, the way people talk about things, because I didn't have a close connection, and because I was in a place where nobody was meditating or nobody was related with Buddhism. So this was like a theoretical knowledge that I acquired during all these years. And when I went to San Francisco in 82, I began to meditate there, and then I continued by myself using books and things like that. And I learned Buddhism like that because I had no masters around.
Well, it's an interesting question. As you know, Buddhism had kind of died out in India more than 1,000 years ago. And so when I was a child there, there was no Buddhism. But I learned about the Buddha because my parents used to dig in the ancient city of Mathura, and they would keep bringing home antiquities. So when they brought home an exquisite little statue of the Buddha, just the head, I was just stunned into stillness. And it was a very important day in my life because I met the Buddha then.
Mm-hmm.
I think I was 6 or 7.
Say it's coming up on maybe 8 or 10 years.
8 or 10 years. And why are you practicing? How did you start practicing meditation?
Well, in my case, I think it's always been present from the time I was like 16 or so, but not in a formal way. It was more something, I don't know, that just, it seemed to always be, have been something called inside of me. I remember when I was 16, I hitchhiked it out west, you know, thinking that I was going to discover enlightenment after having read this book of Hermann Hesse on Siddhartha, you know, so about Siddhartha. But it was probably a very romantic way of seeing practice, and also, and at that time, or just a bit before that, I had problems with drugs and whatnot, and it was sort of like a way to get away from consuming what was more like a pothead or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So,
now you
and also, but then in later years, like when I got back to meditation when I was after 2003, I guess, or something like that, and it was through my doctor. Because I was having severe panic attacks and anxiety, and all the doctors that I had seen, you know, were trying to, were telling me I should be on antidepressants. And this one doctor suggested that I try meditation. So I started getting into meditation in a more formal way.
Probably when I first read a book which was a cross analysis of psychotherapy and Buddhism by Mark Epstein, and I was probably really fascinated by that as I can remember. Yeah, it was probably that, and then that was probably in, ooh, I don't know, last 10 or 11 months ago, maybe a year ago. And so I went to talk to people about it, and eventually joined the college's Buddhist society and started, you know, regularly going to that.
I heard that you're a social worker in Brooklyn. How is Buddhism helping you with your work? Well, does it help at all?
It does. It does. There are a lot of things that I'm exposed to in my everyday life as a social worker, and a lot of it is suffering. And this was an opportunity for me to come to a place and be reminded that being around suffering doesn't mean that I have to absorb that. And there's a way that I can find calmness and strength and be able to be a source of loving kindness and compassion for those who are in need. And that there is a way that you can do that without depleting your own joy, your own love, your own source of strength. And I forget that sometimes and find myself in situations where I feel very empty and very diminished. So this is a really good place to kind of restore some of the things that we know, but just going through your daily task, you forget, and meditation can really bring you to that center. And some of the things we're learning here can actually be taught to a client so that they can find that inner calmness too when they're in the moment of crisis.
think the interesting thing for me with meditation, it's not something that you see tremendous changes in short periods of time, or, you know, that from one day to the next, all of a sudden you're a new person or something. It's really something that's gradual, you know, and it's something that, it's more looking back on patterns or looking back on my life that, oh, you know, I don't react to things the way I used to, or I'm not as triggered by a whole bunch of different events. But it's like, I find it so subtle, the changes, the way they happen. So it's not something that's so obvious, you know, but... yeah, but definitely, or even like when reactions are there, I don't know, it's not so much, I think what's changed, it's more like this interest in looking at how my mind works, or looking how I react to things, rather than trying to find a remedy not to act or react the way I always have. I think it's more that type of experience anyhow for myself.
Do you feel a happier person now?
Happier. I don't think happy is so much the word as like more harmony. In other words, I'm not battling, because I think, you know, in this struggle or in this search to be happy, I think often that's where the conflict is. You know, like I'm going through a period these past few days where, you know, and even like I find it special to be doing the interview now, because I don't feel like I'm sort of like top notch with myself, you know, I've been feeling frustrated these past few days and whatnot. So to me, you know, being happy is, it's more being in harmony with whatever is, you know, it's not so much trying to be a certain way. It's like, well, I feel upset today, well, I'm upset today. And it's just being able to sit and be with feeling upset in that given time and not struggling. It's really living in the present moment with whoever I am and whatever I am now, and not what I want to be or how I should be or how I shouldn't be or so on. You know, it's just, it's more, and I think that's what the whole experience of meditation is for me, you know, is learning to just be more with myself the way I am at any given time or at every in every present moment.
What benefits of meditation do you see for a person of your age?
Incredible benefits. You can clearly see when you seriously are sitting, you feel very calm. You feel as though you don't need a distraction anymore. You don't feel uncomfortable or anxious or awkward. You don't feel awkward not doing anything, which is very important. Also, being alone, it teaches you to really sit with yourself and your problems and let things arise. Because sometimes, you know, awful stuff will come up, but you have to treat it gently. And, like, that's really important for somebody my age to learn. Because if you don't learn it now, it's going to be much harder to learn as you get older. And especially something like that, where it's a mind training technique. Like, the years 18 to 25 are when you have the frontal lobes developing, you know, more seriously, whether it's from a societal perspective or biologically, it happens, and we know this from functional MRIs. And so I think if you're training your mind during that time, it's crucial, absolutely crucial, and it can definitely, you know, put someone's life on track and make them feel okay with them in that situation.